It shows an elitism and condescension towards hardworking Americans that is nothing short of breathtaking. It is hard to imagine someone running for president who is more out of touch with average Americans. The Obama campaign is pointing out the Illinois senator has long said that Americans are upset with their government's broken promises.
Meantime, starting February 1st, a new law takes effect. Those buying handgun ammunition in the state will have to provide dealers with a thumbprint, photo ID, address, and birth date. Also, Californians will no longer be allowed to receive ammo directly through the internet or by mail order.
There are things in this life more important than what we own, and that is the principle in which we live by.
Mr. Holder said during his Senate Judiciary Committee hearing, he stated that gun control is not on the Obama administration's agenda. He said, quote, I have no intention, this administration has no intention of doing anything that would affect a state's regulation of firearms, who can carry a firearm, under what circumstances. There is nothing that we have discussed, nothing that is in planning, nothing that I can imagine that we're going to be doing in that regard. What is your reaction?
Agendas can change on an instant, and so can intentions.
It's been less than a week since the shootings in Tucson shocked America. Since then, we've heard a lot about the suspect in the crime, and we've also learned about the type of gun that was used, not just in Tucson, but in other mass shootings as well.
Many are turning their attention to this weapon. It's the Austrian-made Glock 19. It's the type used by suspected gunman Jared Loughner. And according to Bloomberg's reporting, these guns are flying off the shelves. The reason, gun enthusiasts believe the government may try to ban the weapon as a result of this tragic incident.
Banning handguns or banning semi-automatic handguns like the Glock, and we should be clear that we're talking about semi-automatics as opposed to a single-shot gun like a .44. What can be done?
That the Second Amendment exists so Americans can overthrow the government. That is a view. It is a radical view of gun policy.
That the police can't be there all the time to protect you, and it raises the question, what do you do when you're having to confront a criminal by yourself? And people realize that they may be the final line of defense in that situation.
I'm part of the Neighborhood Crime Watch. The way this works is you watch, I commit the crime.
Oh my God.
No. There's no talking. You just give me your watch and wallet now.
Here's my problem. You're black.
Mr. Crane!
What?
I'm Danny Crane. I'm a big shot.
So am I.
If you kill me, the headline is going to be black guy kills white big shot.
And that's the last thing we need when we're trying to elect an African-American as president.
Dear God. How about if I just blow your brains out right now?
That doesn't work for me. Work for you?
Please.
Hey.
All right. Watch. Wallet. Gun. Knee. Right foot. Left foot. Thank God for guns, huh, Jay?
Metro can't even give me out this motherfucking cone, nigga. Metro can't even give me out this cone. Nobody can. They know I still have to do the goddamn thing on this motherfucker. Let me show your ass up.
I refuse to be a victim of violent crime.
Do you believe the common wisdom is true that no matter the shock, no matter the incident, it doesn't matter how people feel about what happened in Tucson or how long that feeling lasts, that we're really not capable of making any new policy about guns, that we're just politically can't do it?
No, only the pundits say that. If you just talk to people, I was talking to one of your producers who was out there in Tucson last week, and he was saying, you know, that everybody, including people who own guns, were saying that we need to tighten this thing up.
Take a look, though, at these surveillance photos. Investigators say a man and woman wearing masks and armed with guns walked into this bank, pistol whipped two tellers, and then took off with an undisclosed amount of money. The FBI says the two robbers got away in a four-door silver car. You can see it at the top of this surveillance photo.
Dayton police say three armed men burst into a home last Friday, and it was all caught on tape. The surveillance video shows the men inside approaching this home on Owens Drive in Dayton. I'm told the men forced their way inside of the home. All three of them were armed, and one of them stuck a shotgun right in the face of a victim that was in bed. Police hope this video helps them catch the suspects.
The robbers followed him back upstairs, dragged him down, and demanded money. When he told them he didn't have any, they shot him several times in front of his mother. Neighbors heard the commotion.
Loath to bring up what is in our head because we don't like to talk about it so much. But on this particular day, on Martin Luther King Day, I think this needs to be said. Yeah. That imaginary person that's going to break into your home and kill you, who does that person look like? You know, it's not freckled-faced Jimmy down the street, is it really? I mean, that's not what really people, we never really want to talk about the racial or the class part of this in terms of how it's the poor or it's people of color that we imagine that we're afraid of. Why are we afraid? What is that? And it's been a fear that has existed for a very, very long time. The vast majority of these guns are owned by people who live in safe parts of town or mostly in suburbs and rural areas, places where there are very few murders. Your same producer was saying to me backstage here that he was talking to people there who, he says, everybody's packing there. I mean, the surgeons there at the hospital, they said they have guns, everybody has a gun. Yet they all said, we have a very low gun murder rate here in Tucson. So why do you have a gun then? Why do you have a gun? What are you afraid of? What is that thing that we're afraid of, that we want to have a gun in the house?
Let's just deal with this topic factually for a moment. Nothing but the truth. Guns exist, period. There will never be a world totally without guns. Therefore, somebody will always have guns. As more and more government officials call for stricter and stricter gun control laws, can we really trust our government to be the only armed contingent in the country? Let's look at history as a guide. In 1911, Turkey established gun control, and then from 1915 to 1917, 1.5 million Armenians, unable to defend themselves, were rounded up and exterminated. In 1929, the Soviet Union established gun control, and from 1929 to 1953, 20 million dissidents, unable to defend themselves, were rounded up and exterminated. Germany established gun control in 1938, and from 1939 to 1945, a total of 13 million Jews and many others who were unable to defend themselves were rounded up and exterminated. China established gun control in 1935, and from 1948 to 1952, 20 million political dissidents unable to defend themselves were rounded up and exterminated. Guatemala established gun control in 1964. And from 1964 to 1981, 100,000 Mayan Indians, unable to defend themselves, were rounded up and exterminated. Uganda established gun control in 1970. And from 1971 to 1979, 300,000 Christians, unable to defend themselves, were rounded up and exterminated. Cambodia established gun control in 1956, and from 1975 to 1977, 1 million mostly highly educated people, unable to defend themselves, were rounded up and exterminated. Defenseless people who have been rounded up and exterminated in the 20th century because of gun control totals over 56 million people. Governments throughout history have been responsible for more unnatural deaths than all of the street gangs the world over by implementing gun control. Guns in the hands of honest citizens save lives and property, and gun control laws adversely affect only the law-abiding citizens. With guns, our founding fathers understood, we are citizens. Without them, we become subjects. Hitler, Mussolini, Stalin, Mao, Idi Amin, Castro, Pol Pot, all of these monsters began by confiscating private arms, then literally soaking the earth with the blood of tens and tens of millions of their own people. Our founding fathers knew that in order to protect the five precious God-given rights of the First Amendment, those rights that make us distinctly American and the envy of the world, our founding fathers knew that the Second Amendment, the right to defend those rights of the First Amendment, had to remain intact. Is there any wonder, then, why liberal, socialist, and communist-bent government officials around the world are so bent on destroying America's Second Amendment right? Now you know the truth.
Now I want to talk about another thing that's on everybody's mind today, and that's your stick-ups and your skyjackings, which, if that was up to me, I could end the skyjackings tomorrow.
You could?
All you got to do is arm all your passengers. He ain't got no more superiority there. He ain't going to dare to pull out no rod. And then your airlines, then they wouldn't have to chase the passengers on the ground no more. They just pass out the pistols at the beginning of the trip, and they pick them up again at the end. Page quote.
People realized that there was a benefit, or would have been a benefit, if somebody had been there earlier at the scene in order to try to stop the attack. And they realized that even though the police are extremely important in stopping crimes, my research thinks the single most important factor, that the police can't be there all the time to protect you. And it raises the question, what do you do when you're having to confront a criminal by yourself? And people realize that they may be the final line of defense in that situation.
It's only been a day. I missed Mark so much already. I'm never gonna handle a whole week without him. He's gonna be calling tonight. Don't worry. Okay. Love you too. Bye. Hello?
So, it looks as if your little Marky boy doesn't look after his toys while he's away. Lights out.